great man, a godly man, and a single man as well. And this is what he writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse number 7. He says this, "For I wish that all men," and we could say all women as well, because he says that a little later on. He says, "For I wish that all men were even as myself, as I myself, but each one has his own gift from God, one in this manner and another in that. But I say to the unmarried and to the widows," can I have all the unmarried widows wave at me for a minute today? All right, "it is good for them if they remain as I am, but if they cannot exercise self-control, let them marry, for it is better to marry than to burn with passion." And so Paul tells us that he's single, and he says it is really a blessing to him to be single. And he kind of says, "I just wish everybody had the same gift that I have." And he obviously enjoyed being single. He described it as a gift from God. Of course, as he introduces this entire subject, he does bring this one concession. He says, listen, if you can't have self-control, if you're burning with passion, if you find yourself being tempted, you know, to do things that the Word of God says you shouldn't, maybe it's better for you to get married. So he does concede that. And then he goes to kind of give his reasoning why he feels like he's able to talk about singleness. All right, in 1 Corinthians 7:25. Let me read that for you. How many of you tracking with me today? All right. It says, "Now concerning virgins, I have no commandment from the Lord. Yet I give judgment as one whom the Lord in his mercy has made trustworthy." In other words, Paul is saying, I really can't quote Jesus about this aspect of being single. Jesus didn't say much about being single, but he says, "I'm a person that the Lord has put confidence and trust in me, and so I have the Spirit of God, and I'm going to give you my counsel and my advice." And then basically throughout this entire chapter of 1 Corinthians chapter 7, he talks about the reasons why it's a blessing to be single, okay? So I'm going to give you guys 5 reasons why it's a blessing to be single today. And for those of you whom God has blessed with the gift of singleness, these are the very principles which God makes, that God declares why your singleness is so wonderful. All right, how many of you think it's wonderful to be married? Yes, it's also wonderful to be single, okay? And so let me give you these reasons real quickly today. The first reason is this, number one, and by the way, this is not my outline. I swiped it from John MacArthur, okay? So I'm using his outline today, not his whole message, but this is his outline. He says the first reason it is good to be single is because of the pressure of the system. I'm going to explain that, what I mean in a minute. 1 Corinthians 7, let's jump into the Word. All right, it says, "I suppose, therefore, that it is good," talking about being single, "because of the present distress, that it is good for a man to remain as he is. Are you bound to a wife? Do not seek to be loosed. Are you loosed from a wife? Do not seek a wife." And so I want to focus for just a second or two on that part that's underlined on the screen. It says, "because of the present distress." And that word in the Greek, actually the word distress can also be translated as violence, all right? Due to the present violence. In a number of places in the New Testament, it is actually translated in that way. And it's a word that speaks of tremendous, tremendous difficulty. Now, I want you to understand that Paul lived in a time when Christians were being persecuted. The present distress had to do with the fact that Christians were undergoing persecution. In fact, in just 15 years from the writing of this letter, an emperor by the name of Nero would begin a very, very strong persecution against Christians. Many Christians would be burned at the stake. They were going to be fed to the lions. They were going to be hunted down. That persecution incredibly lasted about 200 years from that time. And Paul has seen, as a single man serving the Lord with all of his heart, he had seen, and he talks and he writes about all of the troubles that he had had as a believer in Christ. I mean, there were literally groups of men who had pledged that they were going to kill Paul because he was a believer in Jesus. He had been beaten and shipwrecked and whipped and robbed and stoned and left for dead. So this was very serious stuff. And so as a believer, he knew what it was to literally put his life on the line. And so Paul says, because of the present distress, because of the present violence, maybe it's good that you remain as you are. And I know some of you are thinking, well, boy, I sure am glad I live in the United States of America because we don't have that present distress. Well, let me talk to you about that for just a moment. Our world, the pressure of the system in our world, and I want to just say this morning, the pressure of the Antichrist system in our world is against Christianity. How many of you realize that? Absolutely. Approximately 215 million Christians experience in our world today high, very high, or extreme persecution. Last year in 2017, the total number of persecution incidents in the top 50 most dangerous countries, where they fit in those top 50, but some, probably they do, but it shows that they all increased last year, showing that persecution is on a rising trend in our world today. So just imagine for a minute, how many of you got a good imagination? Imagine that you were living in one of these nations where persecution was erupting, and being single in that place could be a very good big blessing. You say, well, why, Pastor? Because you could run. You could hide. All you have to worry about is yourself. You could move. You could do all kinds of things. And if you have a spouse, and in particular, if you have children, how many of you know it gets more difficult in a time of persecution? Come on. Just a few years ago in our church, we had a man, John Harold. Some of you remember John and Daisy. And John had a cousin who in India was absolutely, they were persecuted and they were martyred for the cause of Christ. They went into the house, drug mom and dad out into the street and killed them right there on the spot, even threatening their children. Can you imagine the horror of all of that? And I know some of you are thinking, well, what does all this have to do with me? I live in the USA, and we're kind of blessed to live in America, aren't we? We don't experience a lot of persecution in our world, but let me tell you, as somebody who studied a lot of prophecy in my life and has taught the book of Revelation several times in my life, I can tell you one thing, that the writer, John the Revelator, and Jesus Christ himself in Matthew chapter 24 tells us that as we approach the end times, how many of you think that we're living in the end? As we approach the end times, things are going to get tougher. It's going to get harder, and I don't want to think that persecution will ever come to the United States of America, but my friend, we don't really know, do we? We don't really know. Certainly during the tribulation, that's going to be happening a lot, and as we approach the tribulation, it could be happening in America, and so that's the first point that Paul says, because of the pressure of the system of the Antichrist, because of the world system that we're living in, it's against Christianity, you've got to be careful about getting married. So anyway, that's just something to think about. All right. You never know when something like that could happen. And then the second reason it's a blessing to be single, and some of y'all are going to smile at this one, is because of the problems of the flesh. All right. 1 Corinthians 7:28. All right. But even if you do marry, you have not sinned. And if a virgin marries, she has not sinned. Nevertheless, this is what Paul writes, such will have trouble in the flesh, but I would spare you. Now, Paul isn't against marriage. He says, it's okay, you can get married. And if you've never been married, that's okay, you can get married. It's not a sin. But this is what he warns them. He says, if you get married, you're going to have some trouble in your life. Not one married person said amen. Y'all love your spouses. That's a good thing, right? And marriage, I think, is going to continue to be, for most people, the route that they take at least at some point in their life. But if you do get married, I can assure you, you're going to have trouble in your life. Paul didn't see marriage as sinful. It's okay. It's a wonderful thing. It's an institution of God. It's a good thing. But you just have to realize that when you get married, it comes with some trouble and some difficulty. I wonder, is there anybody who would be honest enough to at least say an amen, that at least at one point in your marriage or not, you had some trouble in the flesh? Amen. I'll say it. The Message paraphrase quotes this verse as saying like this. This is how he put this verse of 1 Corinthians 7:28. He says, all I am saying is that when you marry, you take on an additional stress and an already stressful time, and I want to spare you if possible. You say, well, what in the world is he talking about? He's talking about the kind of trouble that comes when you decide to live intimately with a person that has a fallen nature, a person that is a sinner, all right? Marriage is the most intimate, wonderful relationship, I believe. But it is very, you do live close to that other person. It can be very fulfilling, but I don't care how holy you think that you and your spouse are. I'm going to tell you that there's coming a day that if you're married, you're going to have a disagreement, you're going to have a fight, you're going to have some trouble. Do I have any witnesses in the house? Amen? And that's because of our humanness. It comes from our sinfulness, the ever-present conflict of married life. And it's interesting, the word trouble in the flesh here, that's the same word that they used to talk about, you know, when they take grapes and they crush them together. It's that word crush, and it means to crush together. And I mean, that's what actually happens in marriage. You get so close, you get crushed together, right? You get pressed together. And you'll experience some trouble. And I know some of you who are single might be thinking, well, man, you don't know my roommate. You know, you don't know the person that I signed a lease with. It's been very difficult for me to live with them, but they couldn't possibly be as close to you as a spouse is. All right, so anytime you press two sinners together, there's going to be trouble. There might be anger, selfishness, childishness, stupidity, forgetfulness, dishonesty, that deception, pride, thoughtlessness, overindulgence, self-centeredness. How many of you know that's trouble? Hello? Quiet in here today. That's all right. I'm just preaching the truth today. And I would suggest to you who are single, all the singles, wait at me just to let me know that you're listening today. I would suggest to you that the most miserable people in the world are not single. The most miserable people in the world are married. Now that doesn't mean all married people are miserable. I'm not miserable. I'm very happy in my marriage. But I'll tell you that the potential for misery in marriage is greater than the potential for misery being single, because when you're single, there's only one person who can make you miserable. Are you tracking with me today? And I've said it before, but the only thing worse than wishing you were married is being married and wishing that you weren't. Hello. I'm talking real today. And all marriages experience difficulty, hardship, sacrifice when you get pressed together. And then you don't want to know what happens is you have children, and then those more little sinners come, and they begin to press themselves and crush themselves into the mix. And has anybody ever had any stress about your kids, about your grandkids? And, oh, I know you. The people in my church have perfect families. It's wonderful to preach to such a great crew as this. But I'm just here today to tell you that if you're honest, you're going to understand that trouble is a part of married life. Amen. And so a lot of people who are single look to marriage as, oh, this is going to be something that saves me from a lot of trouble. My friend, it could be the very thing that brings you a lot of trouble. Are you with me today? And so you say, well, what about marriage? Well, it's not for everybody, but for those who have the gift of being married, it can be a huge blessing. For those who have the gift of being single, marriage may not be the thing that God calls you to. And then number three, how many of you are still tracking with me today?